Martin Zinger-Almanger. I'm teaching physics for the life sciences in particular, but also a similar course for the non-scientists here at Western.
Hi, I'm Phoenix Gu with you today from Western Propology for its professor interview series. I'm here with Dr. Martin Zinke.
In academia, we have, and we should always use, that freedom of just being a collector of ideas and then use them to cross-fertilize into something where you want to do something new.
Okay, so to start, Dr. Zinke, how do you say hello from where you come from?
Well, I think I say hello too. You know that I'm coming from a faraway place, from a very different time, but I think the hello is very universal. At the time, I was coming out of high school, and in the system where I was, I could have gone into medicine directly. I was, based on my marks from high school, borderline. I could have gotten in, I could not have gotten in, I didn't ever try, because I can't see blood, and medicine I kind of associate with having to see blood once in a while. So I could not simply fathom the idea of having a bleeding victim of an accident brought to the emergency room and me working there rather than me being able to run away and let the others do the thing. The traditional way of the professor standing there live talking and writing things on the blackboard,
right.
Isn't that the pinnacle of education? And I would say not by a long shot. So take for example classical opera. Caruso is considered probably the best tenor who was ever around, but you wouldn't know really, because he died in 1921 and not much of a use beyond that point, particularly if you think in terms of him being in an opera house. Would you now say, is there any way of preserving it in time, but also is there a way of being better than what the original approach was? And the ultimate answer is, it is better if you record. Now, and everyone else obviously, had the opera which he recorded as what you possess. And obviously this is tremendously important with a lecture, because at least when I was a student, I went to classrooms, I remember vaguely seeing a rather famous professor standing down there. I probably never learned much that way, because you are in a big room, there's people coming and going, and about the football game. As I record my lecture, I essentially provide something which the individual can view independent of whether there is others or not others in the class, such that it in the end makes no longer a difference whether I teach 1,000 or one.
Well, how do you balance everything between campus life and off-campus life?
Well, the simple answer certainly is live far enough away that you need a little while to walk home. Because if you want to live a life other than spinning your work-related problems 24/7, then a walk, in my case, of about an hour back to my place where I live, instead of using my car. Yes, instead of, I could use a car. I have a car by now, but I don't use it. I walk to work and I walk back. That is, I think, important, because that puts a separation between when it is work-related and what my private life is.
Talking about Star Wars, is it, like, when did you become interested in that? Or was it after you started
Again,
exploring
I think,
physics?
Yeah, it comes back to the same point. I mean, I saw these early movies when they were actually coming out originally a long time ago. And so it was always on my mind. I liked these movies. There is the Jedi, which is a particular character defined obviously with, well, if you take the movie literate, with supernatural abilities. But in a way you can also argue, well, that is just a very conscious person, a very sensitive person, a person who is strong in understanding concepts which go beyond the everyday business of going about your life. At the very other end of what a human could be, you have then H.G. Wells, who wrote the Timeless. The Morlocks are the bad guys, but the Elois are interesting. The Elois are essentially entirely without conscience, without being humans. They are human cattle. You see that they are nice people, but then when you understand that they are really only cattle, that they are missing everything which makes us human beyond the animal, then you start to see that contrast. And so I sometimes like to think about that we are really somewhere between Elois and Jedi. And obviously what our education, but also individually what your development is supposed to do is obviously move you from when you are born, newborn baby, you are essentially an Elois. So you want to move as much as possible to becoming a Jedi in your adult life, which however includes more than just being able to do physics or whatever. It means that as a human being, you have to develop qualities such as sensitivity and whatever, which goes beyond just simply doing the physiologically, biologically normal thing, but going beyond in your mind, going beyond the physical state.
What advice would you give to the upcoming hopeful Jedis to Western?
Well, I think what I personally think, particularly with science students, I think is to take a bit the bigger picture once in a while and to be critical. I like the idea of my students being able to challenge the questions on the unit test before I finalize it, so at least they feel like if they make a strong argument, we take that in account, and we do. Because you get all sorts of interesting things out of that. Such as a student posting a challenge. But because I say, well, it's a TA, the TA judges these challenges. I had interesting cases where then my originally posted answer is defended by another student on the same website, simply because that other student is worried that somehow that TA gets convinced that the wrong answer is right or whatever, and so they rather make sure that it is also explained why it should be A. I said A, to the point that in a recent case there was nothing other than that. So the TA said, well, yeah, you said B, they all said B, but they gave me very good arguments why B is correct. So it was interesting in that way.